It's a pleasure to be here as a statistician, actually. But I'm now an archaeology student in Istanbul University, and I joined the team of the Nif Olympus Survey and Excavation Project as a statistician. First of all, I want to show you where is the Nif Olympus. It's the western side of the Asia Minor, and this project has been carried out more than a decade by Professor Tulunay, and the location is very near to Smyrna, the old name of the İzmir place, and it's located in the Western Anatolian region of modern Turkey. Nif Olympus is a main top site, and it's situated east of İzmir Bay, around the borders of four townships called Kemalpaşa, Torbalı, Buca, and Bornova, and has a 1,510 meters of elevation in the mountain district. This hill, formerly called as Nif, and as I said before, located to east of the city of İzmir. There are five different excavation areas, and these four differ also in terms of the finds, because in Başpınar we have a Byzantine finds, a basilica. In Dağ Kızılca we have a necropolis. In Ballıcaoluk we have a house with a security wall. And Karamattepe, we have a lot of arrowheads, both made by iron and bronze. And what's the meaning of Karamattepe, maybe you wonder. Actually, this little hill belongs to a name called Ahmet, you know, Ahmet. And he has black hair, and the villagers call him Kara Ahmet, Black Ahmet. But in short way, they called him Karamat. So Tepe means hill. This name comes from this man Ahmet. So the scope of the project, as I say, were carried out in mainly Karamattepe. Excavation long since the 2008, and these four areas were registered at first degree archaeological sites. Since this year in Karamattepe, stone fundamentals and some stone wall residues of rectangular rooms, some with curved walls on marl, were unearthed along with the circular pits carved in marl. This settlement belongs to the near geometric archaic period due to the ceramic date from the 8th century BC and to the middle of the 6th century BC. And taking account the 12 information and 2 cremation graves excavated in these years, 2006 and 10, it's probable that this area was used as a necropolis in the Hellenistic period. This is the plan of the Karamattepe. And since 2006, a total of 483 arrowheads made of iron and bronze have been found in area. In the excavation process, Professor Baykan carried out the first typological study related to arrowheads in 2012. These are the arrowheads according to types. They have seven different types. According to analogical typology, they based on the similarities of the previous found arrowheads from the literature or the classical sources. And for example, type 1, I can read the explanation. All the examples of this is iron. All arrowheads, target and square in form, were found at Karamattepe, similar to found at Sardis, mainly Pergamon, Gordium, Boasköy, and etc. And this is based analogically classification. In this study, I aimed to use a statistical method to classify these arrowheads. This is the illustrations of the same ones. In addition to the info, we have a in-home restoration laboratory in our excavation house for especially the metal finds. And the motivation of this type of typology studies is the lack of the academic research, especially on iron or bronze arrowheads, because their restoration process is more troublous than the other finds. And this is the frequency distribution of our arrowheads. The 9 is also not, we cannot classify it in this analogous typology. Most of them comes from the type 1 or 2. The other types are very rare, actually. In my methodology, there are some problems in terms of both archaeological and statistical problems. Mainly in archaeological aspect, it's difficult to date and find analogies for arrowheads from our Karamattepe, as the iron finds in Anatolia were mostly ignored and not published accordingly. And comparing with the Eastern Anatolian and the other few examples can be dated 18th between 16th century BC. Although bronze arrowheads exist with iron examples in past publications, their parallels are being dated between 4th century BC and 6th century AD. And this causes a chronological problem. For this reason, in most publications, their dating have been done with the ones whose stratigraphy is certain, whereas our iron finds are mostly out of an archaeological context, because this excavation area was used for agriculture for years. And this excavation project is continuing more than a decade, as I said before, but I have joined the team last year. And in early years in the excavation project, proper restoration could not be done for metal finds, as the other Turkish examples. And also not all parts were measured. In addition to that, many of arrowheads are not complete in the form, as you see in the pictures. It causes missing data problem for the classification procedure in statistical way. And the last problem is the lower sample sizes for type 4, 5, 6 and 7. It's also a problem for obtaining an accurate method for classification. My main goal is to complete the missing data and then obtain a prediction model for our arrowheads. I have two methodology for this goal. First, I used the multiple imputation method for the missing data, then used the multinomial logistic regression analysis for the classification. These are the variables, the measures of arrowheads. But as I said before, not all these variables were measured for all nearly 500 arrowheads. First of all, statistically, we have to discover our data. All right. In this methodology, if we have a this is the patterns for missing values. If we have a monotone pattern in the top of the right side of the missing data, I can use a univariate imputation method, but because of I don't have a monotone pattern, I have to use a fully conditional specification method. It's based on the Markov Chain Monte Carlo methodology. Maybe some of you have heard before. It's based on the conditional probabilities of the of each variable according to its previous values and the other values and the other parameters of each variable. This is the imputation results. I use SPSS for this procedure, and how we can compare the original data and the completed data in terms of the averages and the standard deviation values, because all data types are quantitative. Then I used the multinomial logit model for the classification. First of all, I combine the four arrowhead types, 4, 5, 6, and 7, because they have a very low sample sizes. It affects the accuracy of my model. Then I use the interaction between weight and leg variables, because their correlation coefficient is very high, and it will cause the collinearity problem in regression models. It's a very big problem in the regression. So I use its interaction as a variable, and the other variable will be selected by the stepwise forward entry method. It considers their statistical significances, actually. And in the final model, I have the interaction variable, the material type, drill length, absence, yes or no, is the is it a full arrowhead or the half, and the elevation in terms of stratigraphy. And this is the results. And when we check the goodness of fit coefficient, it's the seems the efficient for the selected model. And the test statistics key square is statistically significant again. And this is the parameter estimates for my model. And we have to check the X betas in here, in logit models in general. If we have a XB value lower than 1, it means there is a statistical insignificance. Maybe you see here in the type 4 belongs to the lower sample size type. There is a insignificant parameters, because but this is not affect the overall fit of my classification model. And this is the correct assignment rates. In total, I have a 84% correct assignment rate as a result for the classification model. For final marks, I can say for future research, I aim to obtain to excellence of my main classification model by linking our geographical information that data comes from the GIS project. And I think this study as a first step for Eastern metal finds, maybe actually in Arrowheads, because I have to take a more holistic typology study for all metal finds in Eastern Anatolia. Thank you.
Tackled the problem of missing data kind of from the other way.
Right? Yeah. Missing data problems.
Could think that there are some questions. Immediately, I probably would have one. You started already. You used MCMC methodology in general. What was your reason to use the multinomial logistic regression and not, for example, Bayesian classifier? And also, because you already are in the Bayesian framework, right?
Because you said before the measurement problems comes with the classification methodology, but regression models maybe I found more accurate in the classification. Because we can check more than 2-5 and many parameters for the reliability of the whole model. And it depends on the, maybe you know, probability logic models in general. So we can say the results according to reliable probability value as a result.
I'm wondering about multiple implementation, which is estimating a missing value of the others around.
I have to skip in fast. Maybe I can.
Is it connected to some sort of cross validation or jackknife? So to try it out on where we know what the result should be.
All right. In fact, first of all, we discover our missing value patterns. In this chart, we have in red that they are the missing values and the whites are non-missing. If we have a monotone pattern, just like the right top, we can use the basic univariate imputation model, in fact. How can we use this? This is a conditional probability, you know, maybe this is a conditional probability. It means maybe I can try to explain this. Imagine you have a frog in a lake sitting in a stone. Then there are another a lot of stones in the lake. You are trying to find the next road for the frog. It will be going to first stone, second stone, third stone, and it calculates the probability of the road for the next stone, and it depends to the first stone is it's standing. All right, this is the conditional probability approach, and this univariate approach is the same probability model used for each variable. As I showed, I have a lot of variables, and the univariate model says you can use all the same model for each variable. But if I have a monotone pattern, because I have not, I use the fully conditional specification model based on different models for the imputation for each variable. And also each of them depends on the conditional probability of the frog. Okay.
Questions? Maybe a remark. I've seen your confusion matrix at the end, and you used the accuracy measurement.
All right.
It is called a confusion matrix.
right.
And I've seen your accuracy measurement at the end.
Uh-huh.
And I would admit that you don't use the accuracy measurement. Use F measure or equal or position.
Uh-huh.
The accuracy measurement always tends to the biggest class. So that means if you have a skewed distribution,
yeah, all
and
right.
The accuracy will always be high because it fits to that class. And if you calculate the F measure or the recall in that case,
F measure, what's
it? Can be calculated on the confusion matrix also. But the accuracy, you see, at 84%, it tends to the biggest class. And then you will underestimate.
Because the sample size is bigger than the other ones. It's normal.
Yeah, the accuracy matrix.
In terms of accuracy, if the sample size, when the sample size is higher, the accuracy will be higher, of course. Yeah, of course. Because of that, the type for the type 4, the correct percent accuracy is lower than the other ones because of the lower sample size. It's normal. But main aim of this study to figure out a model for the future excavation periods. Although we have in the period we are finding more the type 1 and 2 arrowheads. It's no problem. The type 4 and 3 are rare. Because the this prediction methodology can be useful for in our excavation.
Okay, I think we have to move forward. Thank you. Yeah.